Hi, I'm Gunnery Sergeant Carmen Cordova. Join Petty Officer Chris Avant and me on Navy Marine Corps News. This week, the crew of USS Wasp saved a burning ship. In gratitude, the ship's owner presented a check to the Navy Marine Corps Relief Society. You've done ocean open steaming, but see how USS Harpers Ferry manages the Columbia River. And forward observers trained to keep their eyes and minds focused to support Marines. These stories and more on Navy Marine Corps News.
This week on Navy Marine Corps News, in gratitude for the crew of the USS Wasp saving their ship, Sealand Services Incorporated presents a check to the Navy Marine Corps Relief Society. You've done ocean open steaming, but see how the navigation team on USS Harpers Ferry manages the Columbia River. Marine forward observers trained to keep their eyes and minds focused to support the infantry. These stories and more next on Navy Marine Corps News.
Welcome to Navy Marine Corps News. I'm Gunnery Sergeant Carmen Cordova.
And I'm Petty Officer Chris Avant.
A group of sailors took the lead in a dire situation, and because of their efforts, will end up helping many sailors, Marines, and their families. On April 17th, sailors from USS Wasp came to the rescue of a burning cargo ship. Wasp sailors put out the fire on board Sealand Mariner and gave the crew medical assistance. To show its gratitude, the company that owns the cargo vessel, Sealand Service Incorporated, donated $50,000 to the Navy Marine Corps Relief Society.
The Mariner really was in trouble, and we were just very fortunate that the Wasp was in the vicinity. You were there in the nick of time, and, you know, the men and women of the Wasp really rose to the occasion. And on behalf of the men and women of the Mariner and all of Sealand, I'd like to make this presentation to you. And
thank you very much.
Thank you.
Appreciate that very much.
I think our sailors and Marines on the Wasp did an outstanding job. I'm very proud of them for true heroism that they demonstrated. It really living up to our core values of honor, courage, and commitment.
It was an incredible feat of heroism and teamwork that says a lot about the training we put into our sailors.
The donated money will go to aid sailors and Marines with interest-free loans and grants.
Well, we have about 70,000 clients every year, roughly 20% of the Navy and the Marine Corps people that come in the service at one time or another look to the Society for financial assistance.
Performing courageous acts like that shows the Navy Marine Corps team can and does respond anytime and anywhere. And it's not every day that you can come to someone's assistance in such a big way.
And it's not every day that that thank you touches so many lives. So BZ to the crew of USS Wasp, and special thanks to Sealand Services Incorporated.
Bravo Zulu also goes out to all the newest third class petty officers around the fleet.
Pinning on that new stripe or crow means taking on the challenge of a lot more responsibility.
It sure does. And to prepare sailors to be better leaders, the Navy holds petty officer indoctrination for all future third-class petty officers.
And the Navy is in the process of improving third-class indoc course, and Petty Officer Eric Millam tells us about the test program that's being held here in Washington, D.C.
Petty officer indoctrination is a requirement for all future third-class petty officers. Most of the time, sailors attend 3 days of classes within their command. The First Class Petty Officers Association in the Pentagon is conducting a new 5-day program based on the Navy's leadership course, also known as NAV LEAD.
With the new NAV LEAD program, we kind of incorporated our Petty Officer Indoc with NAV LEAD. We PT 3 times on Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday, and we go over several topics. And we also try to incorporate some of the items we learned in NAV LEAD.
The students are used to doing what it takes to meet PRT requirements, but the physical training in this program gives the students much more than a good workout.
It helped us come together as a team, work together as a team, and find out the importance of how important it really is to be a team, to work as a team.
During the classes, the instructors ask questions and have the students role-play situations to help prepare the future petty officers for the challenges of leadership.
I think when you see the students actually interacting after we've gone over a lesson topic, and you ask them for their input and they start communicating with one another, that's where the students really start learning.
As the students prepare to assume their new responsibilities, they do so with a better knowledge of Navy leadership standards. I'm Petty Officer Eric Millam, Navy Marine Corps News.
I know those new third-class petty officers feel challenged by the new NDOC course, but they sound like they're ready to learn all they can and are prepared to step out in front.
Good luck. In other news, the Navy has been involved with the Drug Education for Youth, or DEFY, program since 1993.
One of the largest DEFY programs is right here in our nation's capital at Naval Air Facility Washington. DEFY is the cornerstone of the SECNAV's Drug Demand Reduction Task Force, and Secretary John Dalton joined the sailors of NAF Washington as they kicked off a week-long DEFY camp, a program that is good for the kids and good for the Navy.
Strong kids, strong families, a ready fleet. I mean, that's readiness is the hallmark of what we do, to being ready to get whatever the Commander-in-Chief asks us to do. Our Navy Marine Corps team has been ready and will continue to be, and programs like this only enhance our readiness.
NAF Washington hosted 37 children of active duty service members for the week-long camp. The sailors who volunteered to run the camp say it's important work.
Well, they need role models, and I believe in helping out the kids. When I was younger, I wish that I had someone, a good role model like that, to follow after. And us being sailors, I think that we should do that.
And the kids understand the importance of the lessons they're learning.
If you do drugs, it can kill you, and you don't want to die. People want to live for a long time and live as long as you can.
It's so great to hear kids talk in such positive terms.
And what a great group of young people. Mm-hmm. I mean, with attitudes that positive, I can see a few future sailors in that bunch.
And Marines.
Okay.
Elsewhere, Quartermasters, or QMs, are the navigation specialists who normally plot a ship's course during open ocean steaming.
But add the fact that they must sometimes guide more than 15,000 tons of a ship and crew through a river only 200 yards wide, and you'll understand why they're the best in the world.
Petty Officer Sonia Hammond brings us a closer look at some QMs making it happen.
Time to turn 4 minutes.
Navigation, the science of getting a ship from point A to point B safely. And recently, USS Harpers Ferry's navigation team boldly went where they haven't gone before, from navigating the wide open waters of the Pacific Ocean to the more restricted waters of the Columbia River.
Open ocean navigation is basically just steaming without any kind of restrictions whatsoever.
In the river, we'll have water about 45, 46 feet deep, and we'll only have maybe 100 yards to port or starboard that we can travel. And it's going to take a lot more people, a lot more concentration.
The ship's quartermasters are prepared for it.
Many, many hours of chart preparation, laying tracks, correcting charts, ordering charts beforehand, a lot of detailed measurements on the charts as far as advance and transfers for figuring out when to turn when you're in the river so that you end up on the next track, right on track.
And to make sure everything is on track, the ship's navigator gives a briefing to personnel involved in the evolution.
Probably be at a sea and anchor detail for 7 hours, 7.5 hours, with the same people just rotating through the watch stations, having to pay close attention to navigational aids, picking out different lights, picking out different towers, shooting bearings to them, making sure that we keep the ship on track and in the center of the 200-yard channel that we have to work with.
When you're in open ocean steaming, on a scale of 1 to 10, you know, you're around a 1 to a 3 generally when you're out to sea. When you're pulling into a river or in any type of restricted maneuvering area, a river or a channel to a bay, you're looking at a stress level increase to 8, 9, 10 sometimes if there's a lot of traffic in the waterway.
And some of the stress comes from making sure Harper's Ferry, more than 15,000 tons, doesn't run into other vessels or land.
I feel very confident about our ability to navigate in any kind of waters or any kind of anywhere.
And it was the team's abilities and confidence that made for a safe arrival in Portland, Oregon. Petty Officer Sonia Hammond on board USS Harper's Ferry.
Those quartermasters are really at the top of their game.
They have great confidence in what they do, and they do it safely.
They sure do. And you know, speaking of safety, it's always a safe idea to take good care of your vehicle. And did you know that the Navy Exchange can special order car parts and truck parts for you?
This is a great deal. You can get products from more than 100 aftermarket manufacturers and do it all in one place, the NEX.
And to help you make your purchase, the Exchange has catalogs featuring special order car parts available in exchanges and auto port centers worldwide.
So, if you're having trouble finding the right part for your car or truck, just head to the Exchange.
Now stay right where you are, because when we come back, we'll see how Marine forward observers train to put ordnance right on target.
Don't go away.
We're with the DEFY camp at Andrews Air Force Base.
And you're watching Navy Marine Corps News.
It's that time again. The July All Hands is out and full of information about surface warfare. Start out with Sentinels. You'll read about those who patrol the waters of the Arabian Gulf. Transporting sailors and Marines is the job of Craftmasters. Learn about them and the giant vehicles they command. Then meet the Navy's most decorated enlisted sailor in a special All Hands interview. Drugs. There's zero tolerance for them, and the Navy team is doing its part to ensure drug traffickers are stopped. Step back in time with a look at the heroic efforts of 19th century sailors in the sinking of the Merrimack. USS Ashland sailors did something very unusual. They went underway with their own enlisted bridge team. Check out how it all came about. Don't miss these stories and more on the July Surface Warfare Edition of All Hands.
Hi, welcome back to Navy Marine Corps News.
Marine infantry is without a doubt the strongest and most important force in the Marine Corps, and the Corps relies on these grunts to win battles.
But there's a group of Marines that grunts rely on, forward observers. FOs call in the big guns and give them directions to smash the enemy.
Lance Corporal David Annarino visited Little Creek, Virginia to check out some forward observers in training.
The Corps uses naval gunfire, artillery, and mortars to soften targets for the infantry. But it's the forward observers that direct that fire. This is where the FOs learn the science of terrain recognition, map reading, and their bread and butter, the call for fire.
Alpha 1 Bravo is Charlie 2 Delta. Fire mission, target number Alpha Foxtrot 3001, over.
This is their battlefield, and it has trained observers successfully since 1957. And the students' mission is simple: destroy the enemy.
Two tanks destroyed, casualties 1-5, over.
Even though you know you're done, the ship doesn't know you're done. So make sure you say over, and then they know you're done.
But there's no room for error, so the Corps packs tons of knowledge into 1 week of training to ensure that doesn't happen, because there's no excuse for a missed target.
You must make sure that the data that you sent the ship is the same data that you want fired.
It's not the artillery's or the naval gunfire's fault, it's ours, because we're the one that told them to fire.
Alpha 1 Bravo, correction direction, 3-400, over.
And what the FOs can see, they hit.
Whole idea is to strike deep before they get close. That's how we support the infantry. We strike deep so their infantry can't get close to us.
And their eyes have to be sharp, their minds focused.
We work for the ships, for RD units, mortar units. We work for everybody who cannot see the target themselves.
Teamwork, that's the key to success for Marine supporting arms. And FOs are a vital portion of that three-part team.
If you look at it, it's like the eyes, the brains, and the muscle. Okay, we're the eyes. The fire direction center would be the brains, and they give all the data to the guns. Then the guns is the muscle. They're the ones that deliver it.
Each rifle company only has a handful of forward observers, and those few take pride in their job.
Someone's got to do this, and you have to have something a little, you have to be either unstable or something wrong with you doing this job. You know, can't do this anywhere else, and they're paying me to go out there and destroy stuff.
End of mission, target neutralized, over.
FOs, doing their part to support the infantry. Lance Corporal David Annarino, Navy Marine Corps News.
You know, FOs can spot and direct fire from 100 to 4,000 meters away from the enemy, and it's that kind of accuracy that helps them take care of their troops.
And you know, you also saw some Navy SEALs getting that training in there as well. Now we're going to show you some sailors in Italy that definitely know how to take care of their ship and others.
That's right. Through underway replenishments, a necessary evolution to maintain a mission-capable forward presence.
Petty Officer Lisa Mikulajczyk of our Sigonella Detachment shows us the dragon whales of USNS Saturn in the Med.
The dedicated Dragon Whales of Helicopter Combat Squadron 8, or HC-8, are based in Norfolk, Virginia. The squadron performs vital mail and cargo transport. And on board the USNS Saturn, this is done by vertically replenishing any ship that needs supplies in the fleet, day or night.
On the average day, which is probably 4 to 5 hours now these days, we can move 200 to 300 pallets pretty easily.
But moving these pallets would not be possible if their H-46s were not maintained, especially since these helos might have to lift as much as 6,000 pounds per load and are constantly running. The squadron maintenance staff is always working to ensure their helos stay in tip-top shape.
We're changing a high-time component, which happens to be the swash plate right here, which actually turns the head when the aircraft's running.
But as with all hard work, there is always a reward.
I really enjoy doing vertical replenishment, bringing all the goods on board this ship to another one. That's our main job out here, and it's a good day's work at the end of the day when you know you've done a lot of loads and a lot of lifts.
The professional crew of HC-8 provides the fleet with all the supplies they need from the air. From the USNS Saturn, I'm Petty Officer Lisa Mikolajczyk for Navy Marine Corps News.
The maintenance on those helos is an ounce of prevention that is definitely worth a pound of cure, especially when supplies have got to be there when they're needed.
And you know, another group of sailors that are always there when you need them are Seabees. And the Seabees of Naval Mobile Construction Battalion One have finished their tour of duty in Tuzla, Bosnia.
While they were there, they made some quality of life improvements to the area's base camps that are making life a little easier for four deployed sailors.
To show us some of that can-do spirit, here's Petty Officer Mark Savage.
The quality of life in Bosnia has improved significantly, and the men and women of Naval Mobile Construction Battalion 1 claim the honor for some of the improvements. NMCB 1 from Gulfport, Mississippi, arrived last October and jumped right into the mud to improve living conditions at many of the area's base camps.
They were living in Humvees for probably 2 or 3 months, and we built all their tents for them, their sea huts, their dining facility, and that was greatly appreciated.
One of their major projects at Eagle Base and Camp Comanche was laying several thousand tons of rocks over mud-filled paths surrounding the two camps' airstrips. The construction of these temporary roads makes it easier for the sentries patrolling the outer perimeter and reaching their security towers. These sailors also improved other areas of the camps. They added 8 bunkers, 2 sea huts, and a recreational tent on Camp Comanche. With all the improvements, it still didn't compare to life back home. But they were surprised how comfortable conditions really are.
I thought it was gonna be a lot worse. I thought we were gonna be living in just tents without anything in them, but it's a lot nicer down here.
From Tuzla, Bosnia, I'm Navy journalist Mark Savage, Navy Marine Corps News.
You know, it's great that the Seabees got out there and they just improved everything for the community there.
Absolutely, and their relief, NMCB 133, will continue to make improvements.
Service members who use military child care should know that weekly rates at military child care centers will increase by 2.8% between August 1st and October 1st this year as the services adopt a new DoD fee schedule.
Child care fees are based on a family's total earned income. Rates are set locally by base commanders, generally based on 10 hours of child care each weekday.
To check the fees in your area, contact your child care facility or local family services center.
Now, when we come back, we head to Hawaii, where we'll show you sailors enjoying the cultural Merri Monarch Festival.
Stay tuned.
Hi, I'm Eric Brown. I'm a seaman from Albuquerque, New Mexico, serving aboard the USS Cimarron, and this is Navy Marine Corps News.
It has arrived, the day when you stop listening to the tales of other lives lived and begin the odyssey that will be your story. When you find the destiny to which you were born, all you need to bring with you is your honor, your courage, and your commitment. It's your journey. Make it a good one. Call 1-800-USA-NAVY. Let the journey begin.
Thanks for staying with us.
Portland, Oregon's Roast Fest is looked forward to by sailors and Marines every year.
The Navy and Marine Corps are welcomed with open arms by the city and treated to a great time.
Taking part in the festival's events is important to many sailors and Marines who attend, but they also take time to help out the community.
Petty Officer Sonia Hammond tells us how sailors and Marines brighten the day for some special children of Portland.
After the military arrives in Portland, people are anxious to meet sailors and Marines and see what the military is like, especially kids. And for some kids, like this group of special needs children, it was a chance to spend quality time with the fleet.
Well, they're here today for a tour of the ship. They're very excited about that. They just really enjoy coming down here, and it's a real unique opportunity. Not a lot of kids get to do this, much less handicapped kids. So this is a real special event.
I feel that they need more attention than they're getting. Like other people, and I feel that's where we come in at, you know, get them, show them a lot of stuff they probably never see again.
It's cool. I like it. It's a lot of fun. I'm learning different stuff I never learned before. I didn't know about. Everybody, we're going to go right
down here, another ladder down. And the same goes for these hearing-impaired children who toured USS Wadsworth.
These kids, they don't typically get these kinds of experiences, and for them to see firsthand what goes on in the ship, at least a little bit they get to see. And the sailors that we were walking around with, they were so friendly and did a great job of explaining things to the kids. There's so much to see, and they're such visual kids. You know, they have to see or touch everything. So they're just in a daze. But
I could feel it moving. The engine was vibrating. And I saw a lot of boats in the river, and I saw the gas mask that you could use for a half hour, and if the smoke is really intense, they have another one that you can put in, and it will keep you breathing. I really enjoyed this book in the Navy. It was cool.
Sailors who weren't showing off their ship got a chance to visit children in the Shriners Hospital.
We all came up here to the hospital to give some toys and just bring a little bit of the Portland Rose Festival to the children that couldn't make it down to see the ships. Rest, just do one-handed. I've got a bad habit of throwing food around. I'm a juggler by not the best juggler, but I like to, my kids enjoy it, so I figured I'd bring a little to the children that were here.
Oh yeah, I think it's really great that they came in to see the kids. Michael got all excited, and it's just, I think it's neat.
And another neat event was the free fishing day, where sailors and Marines got a chance to show underprivileged children how to fish.
We're out here with some kids from, I guess, the boys, local boys and girls clubs around here, and helping them out fishing. Most of them haven't been fishing before, so I was real lucky to come up here, and, you know, I wanted to give something back. You know, they've been real nice to us, and I wanted to help out some of the kids.
I feel really happy.
That was the mission for sailors and Marines, to help make special Portland children happy while making some friends along the way. Petty Officer Sonia Hammond, Portland, Oregon.
You know, you can really tell that those sailors were happy to have the chance to give something back.
True. And if you've never been to the Rose Fest, check it out because it is great, especially the flowers and, of course, the welcome from the city of Portland.
And while we're on the subject of festivals, some Hawaii-based sailors recently had a chance to take part in a special celebration of Hawaiian culture.
Petty Officer Miranda Williams brings us a look at the Merri Monarch Festival.
The Merri Monarch Festival in Hilo, Hawaii is a tradition that dates back 35 years. And for most of that time, Hawaii sailors have watched and even been a part of the festivities. This year, USS Cimarron sailors marched in the festival's parade along with other honored guests of the community.
We'll be marching in the parade today. We're just here to show our support for that, to show that it's now an American tradition as well as a Hawaiian tradition.
I like Hawaii, you know. I like being here, so that's why I wanted to carry the Hawaiian flag. I'm proud to be, you know, representing the Navy in the Monarch Festival. It's a big thing for me.
We're part of their culture. We're in their homeland. So it's only fitting that, you know, we share in their festivities.
While the Cimarron was in Hilo, many people came to see the ship and bring aloha to the crew. The sailors say they were happy for the warm welcome and a chance to share the Navy spirit with the Hilo community.
It lets people remember the Navy's still here, it's still part of their community, and it lets us get to also see the people on the other islands.
By participating in the Merri Monarch Festival, the Cimarron sailors got a deeper appreciation for their Hawaiian culture. From the Merri Monarch Festival in Hilo, Hawaii, I'm Petty Officer Miranda Williams.
Hawaiian culture is so interesting, especially the hula and the way the music and movement tell a story.
And a unique treat for those USS Cimarron sailors.
Sure is. Well, it's time again to get fit. So let's go to Clark Bartram and Navy SEAL HM2 Jeff Bramstead to get shipshape.
It's time to get shipshape. Hi, I'm Clark Bartram, former Marine and internationally ranked amateur natural bodybuilder.
And I'm HM2 Jeff Bramstead, U.S. Navy SEAL.
Today, we're at Marine Corps Base Camp Pendleton at the Assault Amphibian Schools Battalion.
Before we get started, we have some motivated Marines to help us out. We have Gunny Sergeant Dale Hobbs.
Yeah, yeah.
And we have Staff Sergeant Patty Tarver.
Hurrah.
You guys ready to get shipshape?
Sure.
All right. I love the Marine Corps.
That's great, and there's no time like the present to start living healthy and get in shape.
Absolutely right, Jeff. And the time to be fit for life is now. And it's easy when you're living right, and it's easier to stay motivated and be positive about the world around you. Well, today we're going to demonstrate one of my favorite exercises, the one-arm dumbbell row.
Guess what, Clark?
What?
It's one of my favorites, too.
I knew you were going to say that. Well, let's do some then, tough guy.
All right.
Okay, first thing you need to do is grab a dumbbell from the ship gym.
All right.
Okay, now take the dumbbell in one hand. Using your free hand for support, spread your feet about shoulder width apart for stability. Okay, now extend your arm all the way down, and then raise the dumbbell up and pull it into the side of your rib cage, and then just lower it back down again. You should be keeping a straight back as you exercise. Now, breathing is very important here. You want to exhale on the effort, okay, and inhale on the way down. Gunny, you feeling it?
Got the barn.
Hoorah! What do you think?
I think this is a great exercise for the lats and the back.
I think you're right. This does build a lot of strength in the back. And another way you can do this is you can go out, you can grab a chair, or you can get a bench and use that for stability as well.
That's right. And don't forget, it's very important that you stretch before and after exercise or any kind of workout that you'll be doing.
Stretching is very important. Well, that's all the time we have for today. So why don't you get out there and do some one-arm rows?
And remember, think strong, be strong, and make it happen.
So get shipshape.
One-arm dumbbell rows. That looked hard. But I guess the more you do, the stronger you get, and that's something we all want.
Now we go from exercise to entertainment. We turn to an upcoming USO tour. The female R&B group Allure is headed for the Far East and Italy. The four-member group will perform many of their hit songs like Head Over Heels and the certified Gold Plus single, All Cried Out. Look for the group July 4th at Sasebo Naval Base, July 5th at Kadena Air Base, and a July 11th performance in Gaeta, Italy, aboard USS LaSalle. And stay tuned, because at the end of the show, we'll bring you Allure performing their hit, All Cried Out.
And that's the show for this week. As always, we'd like to hear your thoughts and ideas about Navy Marine Corps news, so call our feedback line or send us an email.
You'll see that email address as well as the phone number and mailing address again in a minute. Now, before we go, BZ to FC1 Ralph Pello, FC2 Aubrey White, and FC3 Kevin White, all stationed aboard USS Paul Hamilton. Now, the trio recently earned their enlisted service warfare designations.
Congratulations. We'd also like to say congratulations to Sergeant Edwin Vandenberg of VMA Q1, who was chosen as the Sergeant Charles C. Arndt Marine Intelligence NCO of the Year.
Well done. We'd also like to say hello and thanks for watching to our viewers in Sulphur, Oklahoma, who see us every week on KOKT TV 20.
And a big hello and thanks for watching to the sailors of the Eisenhower Battle Group on deployment in the Mediterranean.
We leave you this week, as promised, with a look at the R&B group Allure and their hit single, All Cried Out. So, have a great week.
Bye-bye.
But
the Mariner really was in trouble, and we were just very fortunate that the WASP was in the vicinity. You were there in the nick of time, and you know, the men and women of the WASP really rose to the occasion. And on behalf of the men and women of the Mariner and all of Sealand, I'd like to make this presentation to you. And
thank you very much, Mr. Pinesi. Appreciate that very much.
I think our sailors and Marines on the WASP did an outstanding job. I'm very proud of them for true heroism that they demonstrated. It really living up to our core values of honor, courage, and commitment.
It was an incredible feat of heroism and teamwork that says a lot about the training we put into our sailors.
Well, we have about 70,000 clients every year, roughly 20% of the Navy and the Marine Corps people that come in the service at one time or another look to the Society for financial assistance.
Petty officer indoctrination is a requirement for all future third class petty officers. Most of the time, sailors attend 3 days of classes within their command. The First Class Petty Officers Association in the Pentagon is conducting a new 5-day program based on the Navy's leadership course, also known as NAV LEAD.
With the new NAV LEAD program, we kind of incorporated our petty officer indoct with NAV LEAD. We PT 3 times on Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday, and we go over several topics, and we also try to incorporate some of the items we learned in NAV LEAD.
The students are used to doing what it takes to meet PRT requirements, but the physical training in this program gives the students much more than a good workout.
It helped us come together as a team, work together as a team, and find out the importance of how important it really is to be a team. Work as a team.
During the classes, the instructors ask questions and have the students role play situations to help prepare the future petty officers for the challenges of leadership.
I think when you see the students actually interacting after we've gone over a lesson topic and you ask them for their input and they start communicating with one another, that's where the students really start learning.
As the students prepare to assume their new responsibilities, they do so with a better knowledge of Navy leadership standards. I'm Petty Officer Eric Millam, Navy Marine Corps News.
Cowards take the low road with drugs and gang membership. You are taking the high road.
We're friends, what it means to be a leader.
And it's true. You
three. Now stay there.
Strong kids, strong families, a ready fleet. I mean, that's the readiness is the hallmark of what we do, to being ready to get whatever the Commander in Chief asks us to do. Our Navy Marine Corps team has been ready and will continue to be, and programs like this only enhance our readiness.
Well, they need role models, and I believe in helping out the kids. When I was younger, I wish that I had someone, a good role model like that, to follow after. And us being sailors, I think that we should do that.
If you do drugs, it can kill you, and you don't want to die. People want to live for a long time and live as long as you can.
Time to turn 4 minutes.
Navigation, the science of getting a ship from point A to point B safely. And recently, USS Harpers Ferry's navigation team boldly went where they haven't gone before, from navigating the wide open waters of the Pacific Ocean to the more restricted waters of the Columbia River.
Open ocean navigation is basically just steaming without any kind of restrictions whatsoever.
In the river, we'll have water about 45, 46 feet deep. And we'll only have maybe 100 yards to port or starboard that we can travel. And it's going to take a lot more people, a lot more concentration.
The ship's quartermasters are prepared for it.
Many, many hours of chart preparation, laying tracks,
correcting charts, ordering charts beforehand, a lot of detail measurements on the charts as far as advance and transfers for figuring out when to turn when you're in the river so that you end up on the next track, right on track.
And to make sure everything is on track, the ship's navigator gives a briefing to personnel involved in the evolution.
Probably be at a sea and anchor detail for 7 hours, 7.5 hours, with the same people just rotating through the watch stations, having to pay close attention to navigational aids, picking out different lights, picking out different towers, shooting bearings to them, making sure that we keep the ship on track and in the center of the 200-yard channel that we have to work with.
When you're in open ocean steaming, on a scale of 1 to 10, you know, you're around a 1 to a 3 generally when you're out to sea. When you're pulling into a river or in any type of restricted maneuvering area, a river, a channel to a bay, you're looking at a stress level increase to 8, 9, 10 sometimes if there's a lot of traffic in the waterway.
And some of the stress comes from making sure Harper's Ferry, more than 15,000 tons, doesn't run into other vessels or land.
I feel very confident about our ability to navigate in any kind of waters or any kind of anywhere.
And it was the team's abilities and confidence that made for a safe arrival in Portland, Oregon. Petty Officer Sonia Hammond on board USS Harper's Ferry.
The Corps uses naval gunfire, artillery, and mortars to soften targets for the infantry. But it's the forward observers that direct that fire. This is where the FOs learn the science of terrain recognition, map reading, and their bread and butter, the call for fire.
Alpha 1 Bravo is Charlie 2 Delta. Fire mission, target number Alpha Foxtrot 3001, over.
This is their battlefield, and it has trained observers successfully since 1957. And the students' mission is simple, destroy the enemy.
Two tanks destroyed. Casualties 1-5. Over.
Even though you know you're done, the ship doesn't know you're done. So make sure you say over, and then they know you're done.
But there's no room for error, so the Corps packs tons of knowledge into 1 week of training to ensure that doesn't happen, because there's no excuse for a missed target.
You must make sure that the data that you sent the ship is the same data that you want fired.
It's not the artillery's or the naval gunfire's fault, it's ours because we're the one that told them to fire.
Alpha 1 Bravo, correction direction, 3-400, over.
And what the FOs can see, they hit.
Whole idea is to strike deep before they get close. That's how we support the infantry. We strike deep so their infantry can't get close to us.
And their eyes have to be sharp, their minds focused.
We work for the ships, for RD units, mortar units. We work for everybody who cannot see the target themselves.
Teamwork, that's the key to success for Marine Supporting Arms. And FOs are a vital portion of that three-part team.
If you look at it, it's like the eyes, the brains, and the muscle. Okay, we're the eyes. The Fire Direction Center would be the brains, and they give all the data to the guns. Then the guns is the muscle. They're the ones that deliver it.
Each rifle company only has a handful of forward observers, and those few take pride in their job.
Someone's got to do this, and you have to have something a little, you have to be either unstable or something wrong with you doing this job. You know, you can't do this anywhere else, and they're paying me to go out there and destroy stuff.
End of mission, target neutralized, over.
FOs, doing their part to support the infantry. Lance Corporal David Annarino, Navy Marine Corps News.
The dedicated Dragon Whales of Helicopter Combat Squadron 8, or HC-8, are based in Norfolk, Virginia. The squadron performs vital mail and cargo transport, and on board the USNS Saturn, this is done by vertically replenishing any ship that needs supplies in the fleet, day or night.
On the average day, which is probably 4 to 5 hours now these days, we can move 200 to 300 pallets pretty easily.
But moving these pallets would not be possible if their H-46s were not maintained, especially since these helos might have to lift as much as 6,000 pounds per load and are constantly running. The squadron maintenance staff is always working to ensure their helos stay in tip-top shape.
We're changing a high time component, which happens to be the swash plate right here, which actually turns the head when the aircraft's running.
But as with all hard work, there is always a reward.
I really enjoy doing a vertical replenishment, bringing all the goods on board this ship to another one. That's our main job out here, and It's a good day's work at the end of the day when you know you've done a lot of loads and a lot of lifts.
The professional crew of HC-8 provides the fleet with all the supplies they need from the air. From the USNS Saturn, I'm Petty Officer Lisa Mikolajczyk for Navy Marine Corps News.
The quality of life in Bosnia has improved significantly, and the men and women of Naval Mobile Construction Battalion 1 claim the honor for some of the improvements. NMCB-1 from Gulfport, Mississippi, arrived last October and jumped right into the mud to improve living conditions at many of the area's base camps.
They were living in Humvees for probably 2 or 3 months, and we built all their tents for them, their sea huts, their dining facility, and that was greatly appreciated.
One of their major projects at Eagle Base and Camp Comanche was laying several thousand tons of rocks over mud-filled paths surrounding the two camps' airstrips. The construction of these temporary roads makes it easier for the sentries patrolling the outer perimeter and reaching their security towers. These sailors also improved other areas of the camps. They added 8 bunkers, 2 sea huts, and a recreational tent on Camp Comanche. With all the improvements, it still didn't compare to life back home. But they were surprised how comfortable conditions really are.
I thought it was gonna be a lot worse. I thought we were gonna be living in just tents without anything in them, but it's a lot nicer down here.
From Tuzla, Bosnia, I'm Navy journalist Mark Savage, Navy Marine Corps News.
After the military arrives in Portland, people are anxious to meet sailors and Marines and see what the military is like, especially kids. And for some kids, like this group of special needs children, it was a chance to spend quality time with the fleet.
They're here today for a tour of the ship. They're very excited about that. They just really enjoy coming down here, and it's a real unique opportunity. Not a lot of kids get to do this, much less handicapped kids. So this is a real special event.
I feel that they need more attention than they're getting. Like other people, and I feel that's where we come in at, you know, get them, show them a lot of stuff they probably never see again.
It's cool. I like it. It's a lot of fun. I'm learning different stuff I never learned before. I didn't know about. Everybody, we're going to go right
down here, another ladder down. And the same goes for these hearing-impaired children who toured USS Wadsworth.
These kids, they don't typically get these kinds of experiences, and for them to see firsthand what goes on in the ship, at least a little bit they get to see. And the sailors that we were walking around with, they were so friendly and did a great job of explaining things to the kids. There's so much to see, and they're such visual kids. You know, they have to see or touch everything. So they're just in a daze. But
I could feel it moving. The engine was vibrating, and I saw a lot of boats in the river, and I saw the gas mask that you could use for a half hour, and if the smoke is really intense, they have another one that you can put in, and it will keep you breathing. I really enjoyed this book in the Navy. It was cool.
Sailors who weren't showing off their ship got a chance to visit children in the Shriners Hospital.
We all came up here to the hospital to give some toys and just bring a little bit of the Portland Rose Festival to the children that couldn't make it down to see the ships. I've got a bad habit of throwing food around. I'm a juggler by not the best juggler, but I like to, my kids enjoy it, so I figured I'd bring a little to the children that were here.
Oh yeah, I think it's really great that they came in to see the kids. Michael got all excited, and it's just, I think it's neat.
And another neat event was the free fishing day, where sailors and Marines got a chance to show underprivileged children how to fish.
We're out here with some kids from, I guess, the boys, local boys and girls clubs around here, and helping them out fishing. Most of them haven't been fishing before, so I was real lucky to come up here, and, you know, I wanted to give something back. You know, they've been real nice to us, and I wanted to help out some of the kids.
I feel really happy.
That was the mission for sailors and Marines, to help make special Portland children happy while making some friends along the way. Petty Officer Sonia Hammond, Portland, Oregon. The Merri Monarch Festival in Hilo, Hawaii is a tradition that dates back 35 years. And for most of that time, Hawaii sailors have watched and even been a part of the festivities. This year, USS Cimarron sailors marched in the festival's parade, along with other honored guests of the community.
We'll be marching in the parade today. We're just here to show our support for that, to show that it's now an American tradition as well as a Hawaiian tradition.
I like Hawaii, you know. I like being here, so that's why I wanted to carry the Hawaiian flag. I'm proud to be, you know, representing the Navy in the Monarch Festival. It's a big thing for me.
We're part of their culture. We're in their homeland. So it's only fitting that, you know, we share in their festivities.
While the Cimarron was in Hilo, many people came to see the ship and bring aloha to the crew. The sailors say they were happy for the warm welcome and a chance to share the Navy spirit with the Hilo community.
That lets people remember the Navy's still here, it's still part of their community, and it lets us get to also see the people on the other islands.
By participating in the Merri Monarch Festival, the Cimarron sailors got a deeper appreciation for their Hawaiian culture. From the Merri Monarch Festival in Hilo, Hawaii, I'm Petty Officer Miranda Williams.